Hey everyone, welcome into the Fantasy Pros Football Podcast. My name is Kyle Yates and I am your host. I'm joined as always by Mike Taglier. You can find and follow us both on Twitter at KyleYNFL and at Mike Taglier NFL. Tags, no Dan today. You going to be doing okay without your BFF here?
How did I know you were going to bring that up? Yeah, I'll manage. Buzz did just fine without Woody for a while. Eventually he got him back. We'll get Dan back. It's going to be fine. I'll talk to Dan tomorrow.
If no one knows why we call Dan Woody, or even that we call Dan Woody, that would be a very confusing sentence. But yeah. We'll just move right past it. I'm excited for today's guest. We've got him back on. It's Matt Friedman. He's the editor-in-chief over at Fantasy Labs, which is part of the Action Network. He can be found on Twitter at MattFTheOracle. Matt, it's been a while since we had you on the podcast. I think the last time was like before the regular season started. Are you you holding up okay? We're halfway through the fantasy football season. You doing all right?
Yeah, I'm doing well. It's been a pretty good season. By the way, I should say, still insulted that you guys won't put me on camera. I know it's because the superior beard game. That's fine. I'll deal with it. But it's great to be back on the show with you guys.
By the way, my beard is out of control. I haven't shaved. I usually just buzz it down, you know, like with a trimmer all the time. And yeah. I think it's now been 3 weeks where I haven't, and it's kind of out of control. My wife is actually pretty ticked off at me.
No, I mean, what happens during football season, it's, you know, personal hygiene, it goes to the wayside mm-hmm. anyway, and then yeah. you add a pandemic on top of it, and you don't need to leave the house as much, then, I mean, there really is a limited reason to take care of yourself. So I understand it completely.
Sure.
This sounds like, for anyone listening, this sounds like we're teeing up a Manscaped ad, but I promise you that we're not. Hey guys, before we get into some news items and our starts and sits of the week, I want to remind everyone about our Start Sit Assistant. With this feature, you can get an instant recommendation on the best lineup for this week. You can view the percentage of experts who would start each player on your roster, and you can edit and set your lineup for any league directly from within My Playbook. And here's the awesome part about this. If you have multiple leagues, you can even view and modify lineups for all of your synced leagues in one place with our multi-league mode, and you can submit your lineups to the respective league hosts with just a couple of clicks. Play your best possible lineup and win your week by using the Start Sit Assistant at fantasypros.com/myplaybook. All right, there's a couple of news items that I want to talk about here. The 49ers had a positive COVID test result this morning, which we later found out was the wide receiver Kendrick Bourne. And this game is now in question, I guess. All indications, though, from the league are that they plan to move forward with this game on Thursday Night Football. So, Tags, is this game happening? Should we expect Thursday Night Football?
As far as I know, they're saying they're going through this whole contract tracing thing. I thought the rule was that they had to have 2 days straight of no positive tests, but apparently that's not the case. So I don't know. Tom Pelissero of NFL Network did come out and say that the game is still unscheduled for tomorrow. So I'm taking it as if the game's going to take place.
It's really interesting because I think the league is kind of done with the wiggle room, right? We saw early on in the season that some of these positive COVID tests came up and they were, okay, let's adjust, you know, the Titans and the Steelers mm-hmm. game. Let's adjust and let's move the bye weeks. I don't think they have much wiggle room anymore with a lot of teams past their bye. So I think they may be moving to the point where they just say, if you have positive COVID tests, like, deal with it. You know, if you're going to play shorthanded, you're going to play shorthanded. Mm-hmm. So really interesting. We'll continue to monitor that. But I do think that we are going to have this game. And of course, we'll talk about it and break it down later on in the show. Additionally, another big piece of news just dropped out of nowhere later on last night that Myles Gaskin, the Miami Dolphins running back, will miss the next 3 weeks with a sprained MCL. So, all right, that hurts a lot of fantasy rosters, but at least Matt Breida is out there and available to be picked up, and he missed practice today too. So, Matt, what do we do with this backfield now? Is Jordan Howard really worth picking up and potentially playing this week?
JoHo season. Yeah, no, I don't know. I honestly don't know what to do. I mean, I'm imagining that Howard, as the sort of incumbent there, might be the guy, but you still have Patrick Laird, our Laird and Savior, and then DeAndre Washington was just added to the team as well. So I'm imagining that we see Howard operate as the early down grinder and goal line vulture, but I don't think it's going to be a situation where any one of these three guys really dominates the backfield. I think it will be something of a committee approach. So Howard is the one, especially in standard leagues, that I think probably has the most value, and maybe even in PPR because he has the chance of getting a touchdown. But I think for the most part, it's a backfield that doesn't really look particularly enticing.
Tags, we don't even know what Breida's injury is, if it even is an injury. There really has been no news. So hopefully by the time this episode comes out, you know, that people have some clarity on this. But did you want to chime in anything here with these Dolphins running backs?
I mean, it probably is going to be a mess. I don't think that I want to play Jordan Howard regardless. The Arizona Cardinals have not allowed a running back to rush for more than 84 yards on the season. They've only allowed 3 rushing touchdowns this year. That Cardinals defense has really turned things around this year. Credit to them. And it's not even necessarily due to the draft picks that they have. They lost Chandler Jones, and they're still playing at a high level, which is kind of crazy. But, yeah, I mean, Breida was going to be a guy that was a borderline top 30 running back for me, but if he were to miss this game, I would guess that I'll probably move Jordan Howard into that like RB 30 to 35 range, but I don't think he's a must start by any reason.
That's good. That's good advice. Additionally, Christian McCaffrey has returned to practice today and practice in full. So congratulations to those fantasy managers who have held on to him for this long. It looks like we're going to get CMC back on the field this weekend. All right, guys, let's move into our starts of the week. We're going to focus on and run through each of the positions, and then we'll flip it and go to some of our sits. But let's look at the running back position here first, looking inside or outside the top 20 running backs in ECR. And again, ECR standing for Expert Consensus Ranking, taking the rankings of all the experts across the industry, putting them together and giving you an average here. So let's go outside the top 20. I had a little bit of difficulty here finding someone that really jumped out, so I'm interested to hear your guys' thoughts. Tags, I'll go to you first. Who is a running back outside the top 20 that you're saying, hey, you should start this guy this week?
Well, what's funny is you and I had the conversation in our chat earlier today, well, last night into today, where I said Jerick McKinnon. Jerick McKinnon's the guy that I'm going to play this week as an RB2, actually. I have him much higher than the consensus right now, and this is never going to come back to, you know, to force me to regret that. But Jerick McKinnon against the Packers team. We obviously know that Kendrick Bourne's now out of the lineup. George Kittle's out of the lineup. Deebo Samuel's out of the lineup. They're just missing a whole bunch of pass catchers in this offense. And let's be real. They're never going to trust Dante Pettis. Trent Taylor is just a guy. Jamichael Hasty is going to see, I would say, most of the first and second down work, and he's going to have value. I still have him as a guy that you could start as a borderline RB2, but I do think that McKinnon's going to offer value as well. If you look at the matchup versus the Packers, they are allowing 16.2 PPR points per game through the air alone. That's the most in the league. It's not based on volume. It's pure efficiency, as they're allowing 2.22 PPR points per target to running backs. So when you look at it and you try and figure out, okay, this team, how are the 49ers going to operate? You know, Nick Mullins, give them some confidence boosters, because again, they only have Brandon Ayuk out there, who's probably going to be shadowed by J.R. Alexander. So Jerick McKinnon, by default, should see 6+ targets in this game. And against this Packers team, it's such a great matchup. They've allowed 14 total touchdowns to running backs through 7 games. I mean, I'm going to play McKinnon here.
Yeah, I mean, it's really hard to feel confident in starting Jerick McKinnon after what we've seen the past couple weeks. But, I mean, very few touches last week. He actually finished last week with, what, 3 rush attempts for -1 yards and a touchdown. You know, so looking at McKinnon, it's very difficult to say, yeah, start this guy with confidence. But you look at Jamichael Hasty and, you know, Tevin Coleman's out this week. Mm-hmm. It really is just Hasty and McKinnon in that backfield, along with all the factors that you mentioned. And additionally, too, Tags, Dante Pettis is actually off the team now. He got released yesterday and waived. So Pettis completely out of the picture here in San Francisco. Poor one out for those who were holding on to hope there that Dante Pettis was going to become a thing. But anyway, so McKinnon, I think it's very difficult for me to fully trust him. We talked about the disparity between our rankings. I have him pretty far down right now, but now that we're factoring in that Kendrick Bourne is going to be out, that you have like guys like Trent Taylor stepping, like, where's the ball going to go? And it is a great matchup. I like the call. Where exactly do you have Jerick McKinnon in your rankings?
I am at 15.
Okay.
I mean, I am.
How does that feel?
It doesn't feel great, I'm not going to lie. But then I look at the names around him and I say, Antonio Gibson, okay. The Giants haven't been bad against the run. He's in a timeshare. You got Justin Jackson, who's definitely in part of a 3-way timeshare now, with Tremaine Pope and Justin Joshua Kelly. I like Jackson, but we can't pretend that there's not risk there. Hasty's definitely there. I like Hasty this week. I might flip the flop those two. Maybe I move McKinnon down to 17, but still, I mean, J.K. Dobbins against Indianapolis. I like Dobbins, and I love the one play upside that he presents, but let's not pretend that Indianapolis is a matchup that you want to attack, especially knowing that Gus Edwards is probably going to get most of the goal line work. So it's just basically who's around him, and I've kind of put him ahead of those guys because I think the upside for Jerick McKinnon, if he gets those, you know, 12 to 15 touches like we know that he can in this offense, I think he's going to live up to that ranking.
So let's put it to the test, Tex. We have a Who Should I Start tool, which you guys can find at fantasypros.com/start. You can enter in up to four players, and you can look and see who the experts are recommending that you start. And so, but one of the tools here is that I can see the most popular searches. So I'm going to throw a few names here involving Jerick McKinnon, and let's see where you land. Jerick McKinnon or Joshua Kelly, who are you picking there?
Oh, it's McKinnon. Not even close, honestly.
Yeah, we'll talk about Joshua Kelly here in a little bit as someone who I like one of his other running backs.
I'm at 44.
Yeah, he's pretty far down. Jerick McKinnon or Zach Moss?
McKinnon.
And then Jerick McKinnon or Melvin Gordon?
I still have McKinnon over Gordon. Gordon is they're letting Philip Lindsay kind of run with that first and second down job. I do like Gordon more than Lindsay this week, but it's just because he's involved a lot more in the passing game, and that's where you kind of have to get it done against Atlanta. I want to say that they're a top five team in terms of points allowed to running backs on the ground. It's through the air you have to do your work.
Okay. Well, I will definitely be going back and looking at my McKinnon ranking, because for you to have him all the way up at 15 and I have him at like 41 right now, is a big difference. So
Matt,
I will be
where are
looking
you at? I got to know.
I'm much lower than you. I'm closer to Kyle. I have him around 41, 44.
I think that's right
but,
where I
but
have
But the
him.
Thing is, yeah. I also haven't accounted yet for Tevin Coleman not being in. But even when I take him out, bump some of that up, I'm still going to be much higher on Hasty than I am on McKinnon.
Yep. Yeah, I have Hasty at 21 for context there. So I do like Jermichael Hasty this week. Let's go to Matt here. Who is a running back that you're saying outside the top 20 that people should consider starting this week?
Okay, I'm going kind of down the board here. I believe in the consensus that we have Gus Edwards around number 33, 35, something like that. I have him around there, but I feel pretty decent about him in some sort of weird way. I don't know why, but I think he's in a good spot just in terms of the usage that he's going to get in that offense. I think, you know, anywhere from like 12 to 16 carries is probably a realistic projection. And it's hard to find someone that far down the board who has that kind of usage built in an offense that is as good and is committed to the running game as the Ravens offense is. And so I know he's not like the sexy J.K. Dobbins type of play that people have in mind, but given how efficient he has been with his touches, you know, a guy who's getting around 5 yards per carry, and that's like pretty consistent throughout his career. And given like the style of play that he has, like he explodes through the hole. Like if you look at next gen stats, he consistently, from his rookie year to this year, has been one of the fastest running backs through the line of scrimmage. So like he's a no-nonsense type of runner, and I think that fits pretty well with what Baltimore is doing. I just feel like he's sort of like the super version of what they have wanted Mark Ingram to be for the past 2 years. And so at 12 to 16 carries, I think there's a pretty high floor with him in the 30s, and also a pretty significant ceiling because he has the opportunity, you know, potentially of getting a couple of touchdowns. Like, I think he's more of the touchdown scorer than J.K. Dobbins is.
Yeah, and I'm glad that you mentioned that last part right there, because he is the goal line back. He, unless J.K. Dobbins breaks away a long play, and we even saw this last week against Pittsburgh, where Edwards was the goal line back there. He did find the end zone, and he contributed for your fantasy football lineup when you plugged him in. So I like the call. I've got him at 26. So he's not someone that I'm saying like he's a locked and loaded, yeah, you must start him. And I like J.K. Dobbins a little bit more than I do Gus Edwards. But yet at the same time, in the running back landscape that we have right now, I think you can plug in Gus Edwards and be super confident and say, like, I know he's going to give me a safe floor, right? I think that's the big thing. Like, right now, all we want in fantasy football is a running back who is not going to just hurt our fantasy football lineup, right? Like, and yet he does come with the upside there. Tough matchup here against Indianapolis. They've been great on the ground, but yet at the same time, we said that about Pittsburgh, and he still contributed. So, Matt, let me put you to the test again with that Who Should I Start tool. I'm going to throw out a couple names here and see who you would go with. Gus Edwards or Damian Harris is a popular search right now. Which one of those would you be going with this week?
That's pretty close. I would probably lean Gus Edwards, but I also do like Damian Harris against the Jets.
Yeah, Damian Harris was someone that I, you know, was thinking about, and I was like, yeah, he'll probably be like RB30 in my rankings. Oh, no, he's RB21. So I really like him this week, too, but Gus Edwards in that same range. Gus Edwards or Zach Moss?
Ooh, I go Gus Edwards.
again, right in that same range. Tags, what do you think here about the call with Gus Edwards? Do you like him this week? Where exactly does he land in your rankings?
Yeah, I have him ahead of ECR. I have him at 27. His ECR is currently number 34, so I like him a little bit more. Now, the concern is definitely the ceiling here because he is a floor play. It's like a better version of Frank Gore. I think he's right in the same conversation as Damian Harris, his guys that are going to split some of the work. They're both in pretty tough matchups in terms of what teams allow on the ground. The reason I like Harris slightly ahead of Edwards is because Harris should get, I think against the Jets, there's going to be more plays available for the Patriots, whereas Baltimore, that's going to be a slow-paced game between those two teams, I would imagine. And the Colts have only allowed 8.9 fantasy points per game on the ground to running backs. And under Matt Eberflus, the defensive coordinator there, we now have a 39-game sample size. They've allowed one 100-yard rusher in that entire time. Like, and it was Derrick Henry when he was on his tear through the league last year. So, I mean, all in all, the Colts have allowed just 94 yards, total yards per game to running backs, which is the lowest mark in the NFL. So I'm worried about the ceiling there for him, but I do think that you could start him as like an RB3 and get a decent floor.
I just to put some more context on this, and I agree with Tags' perspective on that, I actually have Harris ranked ahead just in terms of like median projections.
Right.
I have him projected ahead of Edwards, but I just feel safer about Edwards' floor. And so like when push came to shove, if I'm thinking which one of these guys do I feel confident is going to have like 10 to 15 carries, like there's a scenario where Harris, like something goes wrong, he fumbles, whatever it is, like game script just doesn't go right, where like Harris just doesn't touch the ball in the second half of the game or something like that. Whereas with Edwards, I feel pretty confident he's going to have double digit touches.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. The running back I wanted to bring up here, guys, is Zach Moss. Looking at Zach Moss, he is RB23 in ECR. I have him just in that range, but here's the reason why I feel really confident starting him and plugging him into my lineup this week. Not only is it the goal line opportunities that he's getting in this offense, but listen to this. Devin Singletary's recent snap percentage. I put this out on Twitter earlier today. Week 6 was at 76%. Again, this is Devin Singletary. Week 7, 54%. Week 8, last week, 41% of the snaps. Now, Singletary got a lot of work in that game, but yet he doesn't offer the type of ceiling that Zach Moss does. In that same time, Zach Moss coming back off of his injury, in week 6, 26% snap percentage, week 7, 47%, and week 8, 52% of the snaps. Zach Moss is taking over this backfield, and he has the goal line work. In an offense that wants to, I think, start to take the ball back out of Josh Allen's hands and lean on their run game. Again, they only threw the ball 18 times last week. And I think this is an opportunity here for Zach Moss to just continue. It's a tougher matchup, which is why he lands a little bit further down in my rankings and why I think ECR is priced pretty fairly. But yet, at the same time, I think we should be looking at Zach Moss and saying the arrow is pointing up. And if that's the case, we need to be plugging him into our lineup, especially for some of these rosters that are really hurting right now. So I wanted to bring up Zach Moss and mention him. Tags, what are your thoughts here with Zach Moss and playing him against a Seattle Seahawks defense that has been actually pretty good against the run?
Yeah, I don't know if you want to hear my take on him. I don't like him very much this week. I was with you on Moss last week. I actually predicted that that he kind of overtake Devin Singletary as the primary back there. But I think this game suits Devin Singletary's role in what they do. Despite teams averaging 75 plays per game against the Seahawks, running backs have averaged just 26 touches per game. And so when you split that up between these two, even if you give Moss like the slight, slightly more touches, and it would most of it come down to carries because he's not been heavily involved in the passing game, you're looking at what, like 14 touches for him against Seattle, a team that's actually been really good against running backs. There's been just one running back all year who's totaled more than 65 yards on the ground against them. So you're looking at a touchdown or bust RB3 in my opinion, whereas Devin Singletary is probably the higher floor play in this game. I don't think either of them are great plays that should be inside the top 24 or anything like that, but I think that they're both like RB3 plays. Singletary, the one again with the lower ceiling but higher floor, whereas Moss is more like touchdown or bust guy.
I wanted to bring up Zach Moss because he's back to back in my rankings with Gus Edwards, and I feel like we can have a very similar narrative with both of these players. Mm-hmm. Right, safe floor, has the scoring opportunity in an offense that, you know, and Josh Allen potentially could take away that goal line carry, but yet we're seeing Zach Moss start to be more of a factor at the goal line too. So again, tough matchups here, like, but he's going to get work, and I feel like you can feel confident plugging him into your lineup. Let's move over to the wide receiver position here. Tags, I'm going to throw it to you. A player outside the top 30 that you're looking at saying we should be looking at starting him this week.
It's John Brown. I don't get it. I don't know why people are avoiding this matchup against Seattle at all. Like, this is a team that you absolutely, you just attack them. Wide receivers against them have outscored running backs 57.7 PPR points per game to 23.6. That's a 34-point gap. No other team in the NFL is over a 22-point gap. This is the definition of a funnel defense. There have been 17 wide receivers who have finished with at least 11.5 PPR points against them, which is typically enough to get into wide receiver 3 range. They've played 7 games, and they've allowed 17 wide receivers to get into that wide receiver 3 range. This is stupid. I think that it's very possible that all 3 of the Bills' wide receivers finish as top 36 options this week. And John Brown, as much as his production wasn't there last week, he did play 47 of 58 snaps, which tells me that he's healthy. And in this matchup, again, I think this is a bounce-back game for him. I'm going to talk about this team in tomorrow's DFS show. I love the stack of, like, Josh Allen, John Brown, Stephon Diggs, and then you could obviously get some plays on the other side of the ball too. But John Brown is a guy that in my rankings, I have him all the way up at where did he find up at? I had it pulled up and I went back to running backs. I have John Brown right now as the wide receiver 23 this week.
Wow. Okay, so I love the call. I love John Brown the player. I think that he is crucial to this offense succeeding in Buffalo, and I think that this is an absolute smash spot. I have him at 38 right now. And it's because I'm looking at what he has done recently. Mm-hmm. And yes, we can bake into the, you know, account the injury and everything like that. But I think that a lot of people are going to be very, very hesitant to plug John Brown into their lineup based on what we've seen recently. Now, I wrote up this game earlier for my weekly fantasy projections article, and I said, John Brown hurt you last week if you did plug him into your lineup, which I had to in a couple spots, plugged him in, only, what, one catch for 21 yards on 2 targets. Josh Allen only threw the ball 18 times. Mm-hmm. And so when you look at the snap count, you can say, okay, well, he's on the field. He looks fully healthy. He missed practice today, but it sounds like that was just a Veterans Day off. Like, he should be back hopefully tomorrow. But yet, John Brown, again, it's a very, very good spot for him. To rank him all the way up at 23 is very, very aggressive, in my opinion, based on what we've seen from him the past couple weeks. But yeah, I love the call. I'm just being a little bit more cautious. Yeah.
No, this is my first run through, so there's definitely going to be some adjustments made. But that was, like, basically my feel for him when I came through it, because you look at him versus every other play in that range and you're like, okay. I go through it, and you even look at the games that he's been trying. He's struggled. You know, he struggled against the Rams, probably the number one, number two defense in the league against wide receivers. The next game he struggled was the Kansas City Chiefs, the team that has allowed the fewest yards to wide receivers over the last 2 years combined. And then obviously last week in a game where they threw the ball just 18 times, obviously it's going to be difficult to produce there. And he was working his way through injuries in a couple of those games. So I just feel like this spot, there's a reason that Kendrick Bourne was on our radar last week. You know, I mentioned him as a guy that was a sleeper start last week, and that obviously panned out, even though Jimmy Garoppolo had the worst game of his life for the first, you know, 2.5 quarters, and then Nick Mullins comes in and saves the day. Brandon Ayuk kind of goes off and finished as, what, a top 5 wide receiver. This matchup is just too good to avoid right now. John Brown is a good wide receiver. I know Josh Allen's been struggling a bit, but I'm anticipating 40-plus pass attempts out of this offense this week. I think opponents are averaging 45.6, if I'm not mistaken, 45.6 pass attempts per game against Seattle. So if we get that and John Brown, you know, even if I don't even care if it's just 7 targets against this defense, he's going to hit wide receiver 3 value at least.
Okay, so here are some popular searches, and then we'll go to Matt's guy. Brandon Cooks or John Brown for you, Tags?
I have Brandon Cooks one spot higher.
Okay, John Brown or Jerry Jeudy?
John Brown.
And then let me go here to John Brown or Mike Williams.
John Brown.
Okay. All right. Let's go over to Matt. Who is your wide receiver that you want to bring up here as a start?
All right. I am going super down the board. And this is sort of like if you are desperate and you're trying to look and find someone off of waivers, that kind of thing. I am going with it's kind of embarrassing to say his name. I'm going with Braxton Berrios, and that is only if Jamison Crowder is out, by the way. But I'm kind of under the assumption that Crowder will be out this week. You know, Berrios is around the 60s, which is just like, you know, why would you ever want to play this guy? But in the 4 games in which he's played without Crowder, he's had 7.5 targets per game, 13.3 PPR points per game. Like, that's pretty decent. Like, that's the kind of thing to where it's like, okay, if you pick this guy up off of waivers or this guy's at the end of your bench and you're in a jam, you know, bye weeks, there are COVID cancellations, whatever it is. If you end up starting him and you get that type of production from him, he does not kill your team. Like, he ends up at worst holding serve, and maybe he actually, you know, kind of beats out the guy that's in the flex spot or the, like, the wide receiver three spot that he's going against. So I think there's just tremendous value that he has if Crowder is out, as someone that you can probably get pretty easily in a lot of leagues, or you already have him on your roster. Maybe you kind of don't think about starting him, but he deserves some attention.
Yeah, in full PPR leagues, I don't think we can dispute the fact that he got 11 targets last week. You know, he didn't turn it into much. It was 8 receptions for 34 yards. But yet, in a full PPR league, that's safe volume for a flex play, a guy that you pick up off the waiver wire. Again, this does come with a caveat, like you said, of Jamison Crowder being out of the lineup. But then if he does find the end zone, this is the thing, and granted, it might not happen here with the Jets offense, but yet, if he does find the end zone, you saw in weeks 2 and 3 when Crowder was out of the lineup, he was the wide receiver 16 and the 20 and 24 in half PPR scoring those 2 weeks, in weeks 2 and 3, against San Francisco and Indianapolis. So the target volume is there for Berrios. He has to be able to turn it into something. But yet again, in a full PPR, I don't hate that call. Tags, what are your thoughts here with Berrios really quick before we move on to my guy?
Yeah, no, I haven't written up that game yet. That's one of the games I haven't gotten to. But that's my question to you, Matt, though, is that Berrios, that we might not know about Jamison Crowder's status until Monday. Because they could say he's a game time decision. Like, how are you going to use that decision? Like, if you don't have Crowder on your roster and you're like, all right, do I trust it with Berrios if we hear he's a game time decision? Like, what's your breaking point with him?
Yeah, so I'm going to be monitoring injury reports. The thing that really makes me think that we don't see Crowder is that last week he didn't practice at all. Mm-hmm. And I believe that he is yet to return to practice this week. And so if he is out, Thursday, Friday, I'm going to have the perspective that Berrios is going to be the guy who's playing. If we see Crowder have even limited sessions from the beginning of the week to the end of the week, then I'm going to change course here and assume that Crowder plays.
Yeah, and it's something too worth monitoring. Even if we get a surprise, you know, surprise news on Monday, because again, this is the Monday Night Football game. If we get news that Jamison Crowder does play, you have a pivot option. You have Jacoby Myers, who is most likely there on your waiver wire again for the Patriots. So you can pivot and pick up Jacoby Myers, who would kind of give you the same floor that Braxton Berrios would. Okay, so the guy I want to bring up is Corey Davis. He's wide receiver 33 in ECR right now. I have him much higher than that. I have to go back through this game. Again, my rankings will fluctuate and move as I continue to dive into these. I have him at wide receiver 20 right now, guys. Ooh. And this is because, again, he will come back down with this matchup, but I don't know how much he's going to come down. He has been on fire recently. And I think that this is a situation where if you have Corey Davis, I think you should be starting him and plugging him into your lineup. Obviously, I'm talking about him in this segment. So Corey Davis, target volume is the main thing here. And because you're looking at Adam Humphries with his concussion, correct me if you've heard anything, guys. I haven't heard anything. I doubt he plays this week. He got banged up in that game. So I don't think he comes back into the lineup this week. Jonnu Smith, unfortunately, pains me, is not running routes. He's not a factor as a pass catcher out of the formation there. And you have A.J. Brown, who, yes, can still be a huge, you know, a touchdown machine, but yet the volume, the targets are going Corey Davis's way. So even if he gets, you know, I think he'll get his 8, 9, 10 targets. He might not turn it into much, but yet I think he has an excellent chance of finding the end zone in this one too. So Corey Davis here, this is the test. If we get Corey Davis and he turns out to be a top 30 wide receiver this week, I think it's wheels up for him. And I think that this is a situation where, again, Tags, you've talked about it all off season, all into this season. Great call by you saying that this is a Devontae Parker situation. This is someone who we should keep our eye on as a late breakout player. What do you think here with Corey Davis, Tags? Is he where is he in your rankings?
I have him at 37. I do worry about the matchup and specifically and where he lines up. So he lines up on Kyle Fuller's side of the field more often than not, and that's a tougher matchup. Whereas Jalen Johnson, the rookie, he has to deal with A.J. Brown more of the time. Kyle Fuller's been fantastic playing at like a Pro Bowl level. through eight games now. He's only allowed just over 5 yards per target in his coverage. He's allowed one touchdown on 47 targets. Corey Davis isn't like the biggest, like he's not like the best route runner. He's not a Calvin Ridley. He's not a Jerry Jeudy or anything like that. He's more a guy that wins on physicality. He can create after the catch, but Kyle Fuller is one of been like the surefire tacklers in the NFL this year. He's actually been hitting really hard. He's never been a guy that surprised me when seeing him hit, but he's actually played pretty well. I just think the matchup is really tough, but it is worth noting that A.J. Brown and Corey Davis have basically ran the same amount of routes this year, and Brown and Davis, they have the same exact number of targets, but Davis has two more receptions and 13 more yards. It's just A.J. Brown has scored two more touchdowns, giving him higher fantasy totals, but again, Davis has scored at least 11.9 PPR points in each one of his games. So, I mean, it's weird because it's like one of those moments where Ryan Tannehill has been so efficient and he just breaks efficiency, but the Bears have been so good. It's like David meets Goliath, and it's like which matchup's going to win here? So I know I'm kind of playing it in between. I have Corey Davis as kind of like a high-end wide receiver four that I'd probably be looking to play someone with upside over him. Maybe someone like Jerry Jeudy I would play over Corey Davis.
Okay, yeah, and it's important, too. Like, I wanted to bring him up because for context, too, his wide receiver finishes on the year 20, 32, 41, 31, and 5. Like, he hasn't finished less than the wide receiver 41 on the entire season.
Yeah.
And we just still have this perception of Corey Davis that he's, like, in the 60s. You know, as far as he's a wide receiver 5, 6, flex play. Like, no, we need to be talking about Corey Davis as someone who, again, this is a true test. And if he comes out of this victorious and finishes, you know, again, higher than the wide receiver 41... great. Sign me up. It's wheels up. Okay, let's move over to the tight end position here. Tags a start outside the top 12. Who are you looking at?
I mean, I'm going to let Matt go because I have two. I don't like either of them. I'm going to let Matt take the first one because I don't want to take his because this is just ugly. I mean, tight end is like the worst position of all time.
I assure you there is zero chance you are taking my guy because I, again, am going way down the board. Under the assumption that maybe you are desperate and you're picking someone up off of waivers. The guy I'm going with is Albert Okwuegbunam. And go. I should say, I understand that he had only one target last week. He played, I believe, only 16 snaps. So it's not as if this is a guy who's out there all the time running a ton of routes. But if Tim Patrick is out, and I'm, again, kind of assuming that Patrick is out, I think Albert O is a pretty decent desperation play. One, he's got a great matchup going against that Falcons defense, which is the worst in the league against tight ends. Mm-hmm. He has that shower narrative college connection with quarterback Drew Locke. He's been really efficient on a per target basis. And my sort of, this is not very analytical, but sort of like my gut instinct is that given how good he has been, that the team might start to use him a little bit more, especially if Patrick is out. Maybe they go to more of a two tight end set. And instead of having Deshaun Hamilton out there in three wide receiver sets, they have, I'd say, probably like their best quartet of pass catchers out there with Albert O, Fant, and then you have Jeudy and Hamler. I think potentially they go that way, and so we see Albert O get more action. But even if he's just a part-time player, he's still been efficient enough on a per target basis where I think as a desperation play, again, given the matchup, that he's someone to consider. And I mean, he got there last week, again, only on one target, but we've seen him 3 weeks in a row be someone who's outperformed expectations in one way or another. I think he has a decent chance of that continuing.
Put a number on that, Matt, for us. Where exactly do you have Albert O in your... Because I'm not going to try to pronounce that last name again. Where do you have him in your rankings?
That is a good question. Let me pull it up. I have him number 17.
Okay.
Which, that's probably aggressive, but I don't know. I mean, honestly, like, I want to be fairly aggressive on him because of the upside that I think he has.
That's fair. And I mean, was it 2 weeks ago? Only he had seven targets, like, and Fant had the same number too. I correct me if I'm wrong. I think that was 2 weeks ago. I can look that up in a second. But, you know, like, he has seen volume in this offense before. So, yeah, I don't hate the call. I mean, he's someone that you can plug in as a streaming option. And again, you classified it saying, like, this is if you're desperate, you need someone to pick up, he can be someone that you look at. Tags, let's go to you. Who is a tight end that you're looking to start this week?
I have Evan Engram at tight end 9 this week, so I know I'm higher than consensus on him. I know the last time he struggled against Washington, but Washington has been a team to play tight ends against. There have been 4 tight ends who have hit double-digit PPR points. Landon Collins, they lost him to a torn Achilles, so he's out for the year. That's going to be a hit to the back end of that defense. Evan Engram has 54 targets on the year, but no touchdowns. There's no other tight end that's gone more than 26 targets without a touchdown. So when you see the fact that Washington's allowed a tight end touchdown not every 9.4 targets, this could be the week where regression kind of hits it. If you look at tight ends, what they've done in other matchups versus what they've done against Washington, they actually average 16.3 more fantasy points per game, which ranks sixth in the NFL for tight ends. So I do believe this matchup is better than usual. You have Sterling Shepard out there. You have Darius Slayton out there. There's other guys that teams are probably worried about. Washington, it's more about getting the ball out of your hands because that team brings a nasty pass rush. So I would assume that Evan Engram's going to get targeted quite a bit in this game. So I bumped him into my top 10.
I've got him at tight end 12 this week, so I don't hate the call. Again, following the target volume, I think is a smart move here. Tags, let's put it to the test with the who should I start and the popular searches. Evan Engram or Ross Dwelly, expecting Jordan Reed, of course, not to play tomorrow.
Evan Engram.
A real search.
That is so insulting, yet at the same time, you totally understand it.
Right, exactly. A lot of these guys are just kind of, oh my word, I can't believe we're talking about this. Evan Engram or Hayden Hurst?
I have Evan Engram higher than Hurst this week.
Okay. Logan Thomas or Evan Engram?
Evan Engram.
And then last one, Evan Engram or Mark Andrews?
Mark Andrews. I'm not going to pass up the upside of Andrews. It's a terrible matchup. I'm not going to lie, but I'm still playing Andrews.
Yeah, I have Andrews a little bit further down my rankings. I'm a little bit more concerned with the matchup. All right, I will mention Eric Ebron here. He's sitting just outside the range here that we're looking at, outside the top 12. He's at 13 in ECR right now. I have him at tight end 9. This is just a matchup where I expect the Pittsburgh Steelers offense to just go nuclear. I mean, against Dallas this week, who's stopping this pass offense, right? You're looking at Juju Smith-Schuster should have a great game. Deontay Johnson should bounce back. Chase Claypool can be someone that you look at as a top 30 option. Eric Ebron, I mean, Ben Roethlisberger, arguably a top 5 quarterback this week. Like, James Conner, this offense is just going to go off.
Yeah.
I want the pieces of it. I will take Eric Ebron. I've met 9 right
now. Can we talk about that for a second? Because it is a start-sit show, so it's like I want to get to some more players. And Matt, where are you at on the Steelers wide receiver trio and Eric Ebron for that matter? Because I'm looking at this, I'm writing up this game, and I'm like, there's not really a bad matchup on the field. I mean, Juju probably has the toughest matchup in the slot, to be honest with you. But Deontay Johnson, last week was the first time he didn't see double-digit targets in a full game that he played. Chase Claypool had a 1-target game, popped off, didn't pop off last week, but he scored, he did fine. It's like you have Eric Ebron, who's been getting a solid target share. We all love James Conner this week, obviously. But aren't we a little worried that the lack of competition on the side of the Cowboys ball is going to like kind of leave some Steelers out there hanging dry?
Yeah, I think that's possible. That said, I mean, I think you have to start all your Steelers, you know, like whoever you have, unless it's right. Like James Washington,
right.
you have to start him. I think, you know, Juju is more of a low end wide receiver 2. I think Claypool is, you know, more of like a wide receiver 3 with, you know, like the ability to sublimate into a high end wide receiver 1. You have Eric Ebron as, I think, a low end tight end 1.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, all of these guys have potential.
Yeah, the thing, Tags, is that the weekly implied points here for Pittsburgh is at 28, and that was the last time I checked, and it may have even risen up. So looking at, I mean, Vegas expects points to go up on the board. If that's mm-hmm. the case, then you're getting it through touchdown production. And so, yeah, I agree with Matt's thoughts there. I mentioned Eric Ebron. Let's go over to the quarterback position, guys, and let's just fly through this one. There really is not a huge disparity here. So, Tags, who's the quarterback that you're looking at?
I'll go with Drew Lock. I mean, you start streamers against the Falcons, and that's where I'm at. He's a guy that's, you know, Matt's been saying it. He's like, I'm going to go further down the board. So this is one where I figure I'll go down there, and I'll say he's at 18, and he's available on most waiver wires. I would say in 90% of leagues, he's available out there. But the Falcons, last week against Teddy Bridgewater, That was the first game they held a quarterback to fewer than 19 fantasy points against them, and that game was obviously had some rain involved in it. Thursday night game, there's some variables there.
And Bridgewater left part of it.
He did, and he didn't look great in that game. I know the Falcons have played better ever since they let go of Dan Quinn, but I'm guessing Tack McKinley's going to be suspended for this game after saying some stupid things on social media. But yeah, I'm going to play. If you're looking for a streamer, I have Drew Lock over guys like Drew Brees. I have him over guys like Derek Carr. I even have him over Matthew Stafford.
Interesting. Now, I'm not there. I have Drew Lock a little bit further down my board, but absolutely in that streaming consideration. And again, Dan and I talk about this all the time. Like, the difference between quarterback 15 and 21, you know, it's just like it's decimal points as far as projections. So I don't hate that call at all. Let's go over to you, Matt. Who is someone at the quarterback position that you're saying, hey, we should start this guy?
The guy I'm looking at is Cam Newton. I still think he's a low-end QB1, yep. Should be in the top 12. And right now I think he's around 14 or 15 in the consensus. And a lot of it is just the matchup and then also his ability to run. He's still running at a very high rate. And, you know, as long as quarterbacks still get inordinate fantasy points from running, Newton has to be someone who's considered a starter week to week.
You made my argument for me. That was exactly who I was going to bring up. Cam Newton at quarterback 14 in ECR right now. I have him at 10. So he's not up where I had him previously this season as a top five quarterback. I was all in with Newton, especially after the first couple of games there. Ever since they had that unexpected bye week, we have just not seen Cam Newton look the same. But yet, like you said, Matt, he is continuing to run the football. And that is what makes the difference for fantasy football. So when you're looking at a quarterback who, you know, throws for 300 yards, well, Cam Newton can throw for 175, but he rushes for 60 yards, it's going to equal out. You know, it's one of the disparities in fantasy football, and he's used around the goal line, and this is a plus matchup. So I think you can plug in Cam Newton, again, as a low-end QB1, not saying that he is a locked and loaded starter, but yet I do think that you can plug him into your lineup. Let's go over to our sits of the week here, guys, with the running back position. Tags, I'm going to go to you first. We're looking at guys within the top 20 in ECR that you're saying, hey, let's sit them if we can. Again, comes with the caveat that there's probably not many options in the top 20 of ECR that you can sit, but who is someone that you're fading at least?
I'm not a fan of Leonard Fournette this week. I don't know why people are just bumping him up, like saying that he automatically gets this job. I feel like Bruce Arians is rooting for Ronald Jones to fail at some it just feels that way. I'm not saying it is that way, but that's what it feels like. Like he's just waiting for the opportunity to bench him, but he never completely moves on. Like he never removes him from the equation, and it's left you kind of feeling like, what the hell do I do here? So if Ronald Jones doesn't screw up, you're looking at probably, what, a 50-50 timeshare, and looking against a Saints team that has not allowed a running back to finish better than the RB15 against them all season. I mean, David Montgomery's 89 rushing yards were the most that team's allowed on the ground since 2017. So it's like this Saints defense is legit. They stopped the run. So, I mean, Fournette can catch a few passes here and there, but I'm not starting Fournette as an RB2 this week.
I'm going to disagree with you here. I'm going to start Fournette this week. Looking at, again, I just think that, like you mentioned, I mean, Bruce Arians has just been looking for an excuse to bench Ronald Jones. And Dan and I talked about it on the Tuesday podcast, saying, like, we thought he had a longer leash. We thought that Ronald Jones, based on everything that he had done so far this season, excluding his drops, he looked fantastic on the ground. So we thought that he had earned himself a longer leash. It was a fluke play. He fumbles the football, and he barely sees the field after that. The snap disparity between the two of them was just insane last week. So I really don't think that Ronald Jones can be viewed as anything more than an RB3. And I think that Fournette is going to see a ton of work on the ground in this one. What's Sheldon Rankins' status? I know he left.
He's not going to play. He's got an MCL sprain.
Yeah, so that opens up that middle of that defense just a little bit here. So I think that Leonard Fournette can attack that. And again, he hasn't looked fantastic as a runner, but yet it's his contributions out of the backfield. And again, I do expect points to go up on the board in this one. So I'm going to say I think Fournette is a safer play than a lot of people realize. But I do understand your points, Tags. I mean, it's a backfield that feels gross to say that I've got Leonard Fournette inside my top 20, but I think that that's what we need to be talking about. Let's go to Matt here. Who is someone that you're looking to sit at the running back position within the top 20?
Okay, so I should say I'm not actually sitting him.
Right.
But Ezekiel Elliott is someone who has to be massively downgraded. Like, you should not think of him as a top 12 running back. Like, I think he's a mid-range, maybe even low-end RB2 at this point. He has a reduced workload. He has a bad offensive line, which is resulting in inefficient carries. And he's getting almost no goal line opportunities. And then on top of that, now he has the tough matchup. So, I mean, Ezekiel Elliott, it would be, I think, pretty hard for you if you have Elliott on your team, for you also to have three other guys who have more of a locked-in workload to where you can really afford to put Zeke on the bench. So if you have him, you have to start him, but you just kind of have to hate yourself while you're doing it, because he's not Ezekiel Elliott anymore. He's just a guy who looks like him.
Yeah, I mean, that was the guy on my list too. I mentioned him last week. I had him at RB19 last week, while ECR had him up at 5 at one point during the week, then down to 8, I think, is where he landed before lineups locked. I mean, and he's the last 3 weeks, RB28, RB40, RB32. We cannot trust Zeke anymore as a locked and loaded top 12 running back. Mm-hmm. And now all the points that you made, Matt. Also, we're looking at Garrett Gilbert or Cooper Rush as the starting quarterback for the Dallas Cowboys this week. Like, what is against the Pittsburgh Steelers defense? I'm just, oh my word, I'm staying far away if I can. But again, I don't think that you can. He's RB11 in ECR. I've got him at 19 again this week. So let's go over to the wide receiver position here, as sit tags. Who are you looking at as someone within the top 30 at the wide receiver position?
I don't know why people are still ranking Amari Cooper up there.
Let's talk about it.
I mean, I love Amari. You know I do. I have for a long time. I've been like his number one cheerleader. But this matchup isn't even bad. They've actually allowed the fifth most fantasy points per target to wide receivers, the Steelers have. But it all comes down to the quarterback position. Joe Hayden is going to be the one covering Amari Cooper the majority of the time. He hasn't been untouchable in coverage. But again, if you look at this team as a whole and you say, all right, the Steelers have allowed just 5 wide receivers to total more than 66 yards against them, and that Cooper Rush or, again, whoever is going to be the quarterback, it doesn't really matter at this point. It's sad. It's really sad. And the place that you actually want to attack that team is over the middle of the field. So I would actually think that CeeDee Lamb has a chance to outproduce Amari Cooper in this game, not because he's a better wide receiver, but because he has seen 5 targets in each of the last 2 games, and the middle of the field is there for the taking against Pittsburgh and Mike Hilton. But yeah, Amari, I'm officially worried. I have him as my, I think, wide receiver 32 in my rankings right now. Not happy about it.
I wanted to talk about him because I've got him even further down than that in my rankings right now. And again, these rankings will move. I expect Amari Cooper to come up, but not by much. And I was hoping that you guys were going to be able to talk me off the ledge here. It doesn't sound like that's going to happen. I think Tags is going to join me on the ledge. So with Amari Cooper, I mean, what the heck do we do with him? And I guess I'll put it to the test. Tags, like, Marvin Jones or Amari Cooper this week?
Marvin Jones.
Against Minnesota, Kenny Galladay out this week. That makes a lot of sense. Amari Cooper or Marquise Brown?
I have Marquise Brown higher. I don't love Marquise Brown, but Indianapolis has started to show some weaknesses against wide receivers. So he has seen plenty of targets, plenty of air yards. If Lamar Jackson figures it out at some point, Marquise Brown is the guy that you don't want to be like, oh, damn it, I missed the game. I missed that Will Fuller game.
Right.
He could have that game. The Colts, you know, that's where you get it done against the Colts. So I would take the upside with Marquise Brown.
Matt, I want to bring you into this conversation with Amari Cooper. Who, like, what are your thoughts here? And I'll just phrase it this way. Amari Cooper or Juju Smith-Schuster is a popular search right now. We talked about that matchup. Amari Cooper or Juju Smith-Schuster?
I would go Juju, mm-hmm. in part because I think he obviously has the higher floor. But I'm not as down on Amari as you guys are, although I probably should be. Given the context of the entire situation, the matchup, and then, you know, like, we still don't know who his quarterback is going to be, which is kind of terrifying considering it's like a, you know, like fourth round, sorry, not fourth round, like a fourth stringer.
Mm-hmm, right.
But I mean, I think the question is, how many plays do you expect that Dallas offense to run? And then do you expect them to be, you know, more of a pass heavy game script because they have to pass in order to try to catch up with the Steelers. I mean, if we think that they continue to play with a pace similar to what they've had, and they're, you know, passing not aggressively, but, you know, more than average, like, we could still be looking at Amari with, you know, I don't know, like 7, 7 targets, maybe even more. That's not great. They're not going to be great targets. They're probably not going to be accurate targets, but it's 7 targets with a guy that talented. I don't know. Like, it's hard to say that he's all the way out of being a wide receiver 3.
Yeah. Would you think about someone like Brandon Ayuk? Would you start Brandon Ayuk over Amari Cooper?
Probably. Yeah.
That's what I'm thinking. Like, Cole Beasley, safer floor. I'm not saying it's a massive ceiling, but against Seattle, it's safer floor. Marquise Brown, I mentioned him. Like, what about DJ Chark? If someone's looking at DJ Chark, Amari Cooper.
With Jake Luton as the starting quarterback. Well, no, this week.
So this is perfect, because the guy I'm actually not starting is DJ Chark.
Because
he has that new quarterback, a rookie 6th rounder. I'm assuming that Bradley Roby, shadow cornerback for Houston, coming off of the bye, he was injured 2 weeks ago, but it didn't seem like a serious injury. So I'm assuming that he's going to play and that he will be on Chark, just given the context of everything there, and how diffuse the targets are already in Jacksonville. Chark is someone I'm totally avoiding.
I honestly went into my rankings process, came out, looked at where Chark landed. I was like, I do not feel great about this. He's at 24 right now. Again, I do not feel great about having DJ Chark at wide receiver 24 this week, because we are looking at Jake Luton as a starting quarterback. I scouted Luton coming out in this, in this pre-draft process. Wasn't super impressed with what I saw. So, man, it's a nice matchup outside of Bradley Roby, if you look at the overall whole of the defense. But yet, at the same time, can we really trust Jake Luton? We have no idea who he's going to lock onto, right? And we typically see that with rookie quarterbacks. They lock on it. I mean, Ben DiNucci last week locking onto Michael Gallup. Who is it going to be? Is it going to be LaVisca Chenault? Is it going to be Keelan Cole? What is this offense going to look like? I feel like I'm going to be moving DJ Chark down my rankings quite a bit here as we go throughout the week. Tags, what do you think there about Chark before we move on?
Yep, that's something we don't know. We don't know the answer to that. Houston's a team that you can crush on the ground, but are they going to be able to remain competitive in that game to the point where they don't have to throw the ball a lot? And if they do, I mean, I don't know. It's a similar situation. It really is. Amari Cooper is more talented, but I mean, the defense that they're playing, I think I would rather play a receiver against Houston than I would against Pittsburgh, even though Pittsburgh hasn't been necessarily great against wide receivers this year. So it's ugly, man. Regardless, they're both in wide receiver 3 territory for me.
Tags, I've got a question for you. Would you rather start Amari Cooper or DJ Chark?
I don't know. My rankings my rankings right now have Chark there, but I don't feel great about it. I really don't.
I mean, that's a legitimate thing that some people are going to be having to ask themselves. Like, do I actually sit Amari Cooper this week and play DJ Chark, who's coming off his bye, where do I go with it?
It's pretty stupid. I hate the question. I hate it.
I want to sit both of them if I can. All right, let's move over to the tight end position. Who is a player within the top 12 that we're looking at sitting this week? Tags, we'll go right back to you.
It's Hayden Hurst for me. I mean, he's been actually more consistent than most think. And it's not because I hate him. I think I have him at 13 in my tight end ranking. So it's not like he's crazy low or anything like that. It's just I don't think the matchup is very good against Denver. I believe that this is actually a Julio Jones monster week, where he's going to kind of get targeted 15 times and go bananas for those who play DFS. The Broncos have yet to allow a tight end 50 yards this season. That includes the games against Jonnu Smith, Eric Ebron, Rob Gronkowski, Hunter Henry, Travis Kelce. In fact, just one of those tight ends scored a touchdown, and that was back in week 1. So Hurst is, I just don't feel like he's a great play this week.
Is that factoring in Calvin Ridley being day-to-day, might miss this game? If Calvin Ridley sits, would that change your projection on him?
I am actually projecting Ridley to be out for this game. I think Russell Gage is actually a fine play. But there's also another factor that goes into all of this, is if A.J. Boye misses this game or not. Because if Boye misses the game, that's going to slide Bryce Callahan back out to the perimeter, which means Russell Gage will go against Essang Bassey, whatever you want. I don't know how to pronounce his name, in the slot. And he's been tormented by wide receivers in the slot. He's not good. So Gage's projection would go up. I just think this is Julio Gage territory. Hurst might pan out, but I just don't, in terms of looking at the strengths of the matchup, I don't think it's for tight ends.
Yeah, and again, you're not plummeting him down your rankings. Right. You've got him at 13, so he's still someone that you can roll out. I would phrase it to you that the question I'd ask is, if you have Hayden Hurst on your roster and you don't have any other tight end rostered, would you drop Hayden Hurst to go pick up a tight end?
Absolutely.
Or would you still just at that point play Hayden Hurst?
No, Hayden Hurst has actually been pretty good. I mean, he's totaled at least 51 yards and or a touchdown in 6 of the last 7 games. So it's about all you can ask for out of a tight end.
Yeah. All right, Matt, who is a tight end that you're looking at sitting this week?
Jared Cook, and he hasn't been getting all that many targets this year anyway, so I feel like there's been a little bit of flukiness with his production. And then now it looks like Emmanuel Sanders is returning. Maybe Michael Thomas returns, maybe not. But as long as Emmanuel Sanders is out there, I think Sanders is going to be a guy who's getting a lot of the targets that maybe otherwise would have been going to Jared Cook. So just with reduced target opportunities in general and the fact that he hasn't gotten all that many targets this year already, I will be looking to fade Jared Cook.
You mentioned like his production this year has been fluky. I mean, it's been the past 2 years that he breaks all efficiency metrics looking at what, you know, targets and touchdowns. I mean, he just scores a touchdown nearly every game. So, yeah, he always has the potential. But as far as the target totals, man, it's just not going to be there. So he has to do it on the back of a touchdown. I classify him as kind of this high end tight end two that's touchdown or bust. So it feels like you're kind of in that same range. The guy I'll mention is Mike Gesicki. Gesicki at tight end 12 in ECR right now. I have him a little bit further down at tight end 16. But with the way Tua Tagovailoa looked in his first game, mirrors what he did at Alabama. He's he distributes the ball evenly. You look at the target share and the target distribution that Tua had. Granted, he didn't have a ton of opportunity last week. Only, 22 total pass attempts with the defense going up super big and getting them some points there. But I don't know if the target volume is here for Gesicki. He's going to have to find the end zone. He's going to have to break away a long play, which he certainly can do, but yet I don't know. I don't want to bank on that. So I have him a little bit further down there at tight end 16. Let's touch on the quarterback super quick, and then we'll get to our sleepers. I'll just go with mine, guys. It's Lamar Jackson. He's the quarterback 14 on the entire season, and that's where he lands in my rankings this week. He is QB 8 in ECR. So this is saying that the experts are down on Lamar Jackson as a whole, right? Right, because we've been talking about Lamar Jackson as a top five lock all season long. Just hasn't happened. He hasn't been delivering those huge blow-up games, again, against a very good Indianapolis defense here. I don't see it happening for Lamar Jackson this week. I want to play it a little bit more safe. So he's at QB 14 in my rankings. He falls outside my top 12. Tags, who is a quarterback that you're sitting this week?
I mean, ideally you sit Ryan Tannehill. I hate saying it. I do. Because Ryan Tannehill's like, again, it's David versus Goliath here in terms of, like, you know, they're clashing these two. And I just don't know if the Titans are able to be as efficient against this Bears defense. The Bears have been equally as inefficient or as efficient on defense as the Titans have been on offense. So it's like these two are going to collide. I just don't see much of a ceiling there for Tannehill.
excuse me. Matt, what about you?
I'm totally with you on Lamar Jackson. That was the guy I was going to talk about for all the reasons you outlined. I view him more as a low-end QB1 with upside, so I think if you have him, you still have to start him, but as was the case with Zeke, you have to adjust your expectations down.
Right.
The Ravens are running fewer plays per game this year, and he hasn't progressed as a passer. He's not throwing as many touchdowns as he did last year, so he's just not the same guy.
Let's move over to the sleepers, guys, outside the top 50, or outside the top 36, excuse me, at the running back position. Let's all mention our running back here really quick. Tags, a running back outside the top 36 that you're saying, if you need a sleeper option, you should be looking at this guy. Who is it?
J.D. McKissick is fine.
No more analysis on
no,
that?
No, I don't want to give any analysis. I just want to tell you to play J.D. McKissick. I mean, if you're looking for somebody that's available in most leagues, he's been a guy that you could plug and play during bye weeks. I have him ranked as a top 36 running back this week, so yeah.
Yeah, his production fell down a little bit last week, or two weeks ago, because they had their bye last week. That was in a game that they were up big on Dallas. Mm-hmm. They didn't need him. I expect that they'll need him a little bit more this week against New York. Matt, what about for you, a running back outside the top 36 that you're saying is a sleeper this week?
This is looking more directly at the Thursday night football game, assuming it plays. But Dexter Williams, you know, I think it's going to be Dexter Williams or Tyler Irvin as the guy who ends up kind of being the lead back. I lean a little bit more towards Dexter Williams as the, you know, between the tackles grinder and maybe the guy who has the goal line opportunities. But, I mean, who really knows between those two? But if I had to pick one, I would go with Williams. And he's out there on waivers in a lot of leagues. I mean, almost every league.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, crap, for guys. Sure. Got some breaking news in the middle of the show here.
Go ahead.
Matthew Stafford has been placed on the COVID list.
Oh, great.
Obviously not going to play this week. It hurts Marvin Jones quite a bit. Also, Alvin Kamara missed practice with some sort of foot injury.
Fantastic.
Yeah. Good news, right?
No. Yeah, and bad. Packers are listing Aaron Jones as questionable for Thursday night's game versus the 49ers. We'll touch on that game in just a minute. Let's move forward. My sleeper of the week at the running back position is Tremaine Pope. the running back for the Los Angeles Chargers. The question over the past couple weeks has been Justin Jackson or Joshua Kelly, and apparently the answer was Tremaine Pope. So he is getting work in this backfield. He is a spark plug. He is picking up chunk gains on the ground. So again, I don't have him ranked super high, but yet if you need a fill-in option, again, you talk about, like, you know, like you mentioned, Matt, someone who is available on waivers. Tremaine Pope is available on your waiver wire. You can plug him in if you are absolutely in a pinch. Let's go to the wide receiver position. Someone outside the top 50 wide receivers. I'll just mention my guy really quick, guys. Anthony Miller. And it's looking at his snap percentage going way up. I know, Tags, you were talking about it could be part of Allen Robinson missing all practice all of last week. It could be that they, Matt Nagy finally.
No way.
Yeah, dude, very small percentage chance that that is actually the case. But yet there is, I mentioned I did a stashes and streamers video that goes up on our YouTube channel at youtube.com/fantasypros. And I said, add Anthony Miller if you have the space, because there is a potential chance that he is actually someone that will become a full-time player, and not full-time, but a significant player in this offense, going from 61% snap percentage in week 7 to then 81% last week. So 11 targets last week. He's always had the talent. It's just been a usage question. So I think that if you are desperate again at the position, you can plug in Anthony Miller, and I do recommend adding him just in case that this does become just because it wasn't a fluke, moving forward. So Tags, let's go to you, a sleeper at the wide receiver position.
Tim Patrick, as long as he plays, I think that he's someone that you should definitely plug into lineups if you're desperate, because the Falcons are a team that have just been burned continually. They've shifted around cornerbacks. They've done whatever they can. This is going back to the conversation we had earlier about Melvin Gordon and Phillip Lindsay and that backfield, is that the Falcons have actually been a really good run defense in terms of the production they've allowed on the ground. Everything is through the air. So Tim Patrick, Jerry Jeudy, it's a very top-heavy team in terms of where the targets go. Noah Fant, Albert O, I'm guessing that's why Matt picked that one out. So I do think that Tim Patrick, as long as he's back in the lineup, I think he's someone that I would play.
I like that call. Matt, what about you? Who is a sleeper wide receiver here for you?
I would say, in light of the Matthew Stafford news, I would maybe go Danny Amendola. So no Golladay. So Amendola might have more targets coming his way anyway. In the 2 weeks without Golladay, in weeks 1 and 2, he saw 7 targets both of those games. And I'm thinking with Chase Daniel, I'm assuming that Chase Daniel is the backup quarterback. I should verify that, but
not David Blau.
Yeah. I'm thinking with Daniel there, who's more of a, kind of short arm passer. He might be more inclined to go towards Amendola or towards someone in the middle of the field versus Marvin Jones down the field or Quintez Cephas or whoever it is. So Amendola is, but I mean, he's a deep, deep dart throw. But I could see him ending up with, something like 8 to 10 targets.
All right, let's go to our start and sit of the week. Again, this is just a flag planting. Who is this guy that you want to attach your name to this week? So let's go with our start of the week. For me, it's Eric Ebron. I talked about him looking at the opportunity that he has here in this matchup against Dallas. I expect points to go up on the board. And Ebron's brought a safe floor every single week. So if you are looking at the tight end position, you're kind of wondering who the heck you should be starting, you've got a couple options, and Ebron's on your roster or even on your waiver wire, I would recommend plugging in Eric Ebron into your lineup. Tags, who is your start of the week?
I'm going to stick my name by John Brown. I already talked about him quite a bit, and I'm going to find a way to get him in the lineups.
Matt, what about you? Start of the week.
Is it too easy to go with Julio Jones? I mean, like, I know, like, I want to say, like, number one. Like, he's the number one receiver, so it's not like you're always starting Julio, but, like, this week you're, like, starting Julio, and then you're just celebrating before the game starts. DFS. Like, I think it's a massive, massive win for Julio this week.
Let's go over to our sits of the week. I talked about Amari Cooper. I am going to stay by that. Again, another option would be Ezekiel Elliott, but I will go with a sit of the week as Amari Cooper.
Yeah, there's going to be some people looking at Christian Kirk as a guy that they can play now that he's coming off. I think he scored 4 touchdowns in the last 2 games. He's had 3 solid games fantasy-wise, but that's going to happen when you play against the Seahawks, the Jets, and who was the last one they played against? It was the Cowboys, remember. That's right. Miami's actually allowed the 6th fewest fantasy points to wide receiver, and where Christian Kirk lines up is on Xavier Howard's side of the field, so I do not see much production going his way.
Matt, what about you? Sit of the week.
Zeke. Pretty handily Zeke.
Nice. Yep, I am in agreement there. All right, let's focus in on the Thursday night preview. This should be a very interesting game, looking at a lot of players out for this one, obviously with Kendrick Bourne being out on the 49ers side, and then also with Aaron Jones being listed as questionable to then Jamal Williams. So I'll just run through some questions here, guys. Tags, Aaron Rodgers, is he a top five quarterback this week?
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty hard to say that he's not, just considering the lack of run game. I guess it should depend on Aaron Jones if he plays or not, because if the run game gets a boost, then they're going to rely on it a little bit more. But if it's Dexter Williams and Tyler Irvin out there, Irvin's a wide receiver, basically. And Dexter Williams is a guy that, you know, he's just a guy. I would say Rodgers. I'll say top eight for sure. But it's tough, man. I'm looking at all this. We don't know if Alan Lazard is going to play. We don't know about the running back. So there's just some question marks that I don't like about this game. But yeah, He's definitely someone you're going to start.
So let's assume that Aaron Jones is out, just for argument's sake. Which Green Bay running back are you guys starting? I'll go to Matt first. Are you starting either of them? I mean, you mentioned Dexter Williams, but yeah, if push comes to shove, are you actually looking to start either of them?
Yeah, I think Dexter Williams. I mean, he's sort of like the perfect injury fill-in bye week, 1 week running back. You know, like we get guys like that every year where you're desperate, and then there's someone who just pops up on waivers. He feels like that guy. And so, as a flex play, I think Williams slots in.
Tags, any other Green Bay wide receiver besides Davante Adams? Let's just assume. I haven't heard anything on Alan Lazard, so at this point, I'm assuming that he doesn't play. But if he sits, is there any other Green Bay wide receiver that you're looking at?
Absolutely not. The running backs. I also have Dexter Williams higher because I think that he's the best shot at the goal line carry. Again, Irvin's been like, he's pretty much played like a wide receiver. So I would say Dexter Williams. I'd prefer him over Tyler Irvin.
On the Green Bay side, Robert Tonyan, a top five play at the tight end position this week?
No. Top five.
Where does he land in your rankings? Because I'm a little bit more optimistic on Tonyan.
I have him at 13.
13, okay. Matt, where does Robert Tonyan land in your rankings?
Outside the top 12 for sure. Okay. I'd say more of like a mid-range tight end too.
Yeah, it's for me looking at where do the touchdowns go. If Aaron Jones comes back into this game, then that's where the touchdowns go. Then obviously that would fall down or cause Tonyan to fall down my rankings, but I do have him a little bit higher than ECR this week. Let's flip over to San Francisco. Obviously, no Jimmy Garoppolo, no George Kittle this week. Obviously, no Kendrick Bourne. Now
we're looking at
no Debo Samuel. We are looking at Brandon Ayuk, Trent Taylor, maybe Jordan Reed, if not Ross Dwelly. I mean, I just feel so bad for San Francisco. Their injuries that they have suffered this year and every year for the past couple of years has just been brutal. So Nick Mullins will be starting. Are we looking his way at all for fantasy?
No.
Yeah, I would agree with that. It's in a two QB league, I think you can get away with him. But in a one QB league, I'm not considering him as a streamer. How do we see this San Francisco backfield breaking down, Tags? Obviously, you mentioned you really like Jerick McKinnon this week. Matt and I are a little bit further down the rankings on McKinnon. We like Hasty. So how exactly do we see this backfield breaking down?
I think that they're both guys that you can consider top 20 plays. Honestly, I think that they're both going to have production. And I might flip-flop those guys and just say, all right, I'm willing to put Hasty over Jerick McKinnon. But, I mean, this Packers team, in terms of, like, opportunity, like, even if you go through weighted opportunity and you look at that, they've allowed 18% more fantasy points than any other team on a point-per-opportunity basis. 18%. That's ridiculous.
How high does Brandon Ayuk move in your guys' rankings now with Kendrick Bourne out? Obviously, you mentioned at Tags that they might just shadow Ayuk with Jair Alexander now. So where does he land in your rankings with Kendrick Bourne out?
He's at 28, I think, among wide receivers. I'm not psyched about him. Am I wrong about that, Matt?
Yeah, I mean, who knows? Because Alexander is really good. But I think Ayuk, especially now with Bourne out, is just going to have so many targets going his way, that I think he's more of a wide receiver too at this point. Yeah. I'd maybe even say high end wide receiver too, but that feels aggressive, but I mean, just targets, they, you know, they handle so many shortcomings. And there are shortcomings there with that passing offense and then with Alexander on him. But, I mean, the targets overwhelm.
That's fair.
Yeah, I mean, that was my thing, looking at the projections going, like, where the heck is the ball going to go? Because George Kittle out, Deebo Samuel out. I mean, Jerick McKinnon, maybe. But, you know, we obviously differ on that. So, yeah, I have Ayuk as a mid-range wide receiver two this week. May bump him down based on the Jair Alexander matchup, but I still think he is absolutely a start. And then lastly, guys, with this, I'm not sure if Jordan Reed is going to be ready to go to play this week. If he is Ross Dwelly someone you're looking at? I mean, to stream. Like, you're not super confident in Ross Dwelly, but
yeah,
yet,
I mean,
is he someone that you can plug into your lineup?
Yeah, if Reed is out, then yeah, I think Dwelly is streamable. I think he would actually be a decent streaming option if you're desperate, especially now that Bourne is out. If Reed is in, I mean, obviously Reed, he looks much more like the guy.
Yeah, I mean, and again, it's the argument of the targets have to go somewhere. So, I mean, Matt, you mentioned Albert Okwuegbunam. Like, would you start, if Jordan Reed is out, would you rather start Ross Dwelly or would you rather start Albert O?
Probably Dwelly. I mean, he has the higher target floor.
Yeah, I would agree with that. Better matchup for Alberto, but yet the higher target volume for Ross Dwelly. Mm-hmm. All right, guys, that is going to do it for today's show. Huge thank you to Matt Friedman for coming on today's podcast. Remind everyone, Matt, where they can find and follow you on Twitter.
You can follow me on Twitter at MattFTheOracle, and you can find all of my content at Action Network and Fantasy Labs. And on Twitter, I do daily AMAs, you know, very, very focused on fantasy, you know, start sit questions, trade questions, everything like that. And that's every day whenever I can, you know, find 30 minutes to carve out. Be sure to check it out.
Yeah, absolutely, Matt. Thank you so much for coming on. We'll be back with another episode tomorrow. Tags will be breaking down the DFS plays for this upcoming week. And then Dan and I will be back with you all on Friday, breaking down every matchup from a fantasy perspective. For Mike Taglier and Matt Friedman, I'm Kyle Yates, and we'll see you next time.
Thanks for tuning in to the Fantasy Pros YouTube channel. Make sure to check out our featured videos as well. Also, make sure to click that red subscribe button to get notified when we post videos in the future.